Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, for the Fringe FM, coming at you live from the middle of nowhere, the center of everywhere, here once again to give you yet another scrumptious dose of conversational boogie. This is Shift Happens. Oh yeah, wait for it. What's happening, folks? Do follow us on Twitter over at Shift Happens Pod and all of our other social media links over there at shifthappensradio.com, including my personal Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all that good stuff is all over there. We're back another Friday. What's up, everybody in the chat, both chats? Good to see ya. Good to be here. Gotta love it. And joining us also, as per usual, is our trusty co-host, JP. What's happening, JP?
Not too much. You were absolutely on fire last night. You and I went on Just Rogie's show, and I was thoroughly entertained and just trying my best to contribute, but I was just happy listening, to be honest. It was a great time, and thanks to Jess Rogie for having us on, of course.
Yeah, definitely. In case you guys missed it, like JP just said, we were on Jess Rogie's show last night. A fun episode. It was all about personal psychedelic experiences, mostly of the DMT variety. And speaking of thanking Jess, also thanks to Jess for swinging us onto the network tonight with all the new changes happening with the network. I wasn't able to plug in the normal way, not until next week anyway, so Jess came in and saved the day. She also did some editing work for me as well today, and so,
nice.
Yeah, Jess is a superhero, so... She's the reason why we're on the air and the reason why my commercial breaks are current as of today. So,
and it's also why I'm a Jess Rogie super fan. But yeah, she's so our shows are intertwined. And yeah, it definitely works both ways when she comes and visits us and when we go over to her show. So there's absolutely. Always that.
And you know what I did, which you guys should do as well, is I bought her some coffee. Over there at buymeacoffee.com/Jess Rogie. You can go buy her a coffee and help support her show and the work she does. And you can buy us a coffee too. Same thing. buymeacoffee.com/shifthappens. And you can pitch into the show, and every little bit of caffeine and cents are appreciated.
Absolutely. I don't know about you, but I could use a cup of coffee sometimes, and that's sometimes like every day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, dude. Life would be a lot less feasible without just simple coffee. I mean, I'm mostly stuck with Kratom, but now I'm kind of back and forth between both. I got my own coffee machine finally, you know, chucked a little $40 at it. Yeah, because I was just thinking, you know, I'm spending like $3 for a cup of coffee every morning when I could buy a big tub of grinded beans for $7 that'll last God knows how long. And so, yeah, I'm now a coffee person again, officially.
Yeah, I bought a, what do you call it? I bought an espresso making machine. Really nice. I don't know how, but it was laying there at a thrift store in Silver Lake, and it was $15. And I thought, even if I get like three or four coffees out of this thing, it'll pay for itself. So I bought it, and 3 years later, that thing still runs like a gem. It's the best deal I ever bought on anything. And so, but lately it's clogging up. So please don't let anybody out there think buying me a coffee would be a mistake, since I have this espresso maker. I love coffee, and I'll drink it anytime.
Absolutely. There you go. And I really wish I had one of those. Like, my sister has one of those machines where you buy the little, like, little cups that you plug into the machine. They're like tiny little cups, like the ones that creamers come in. But it's the coffee in one of those size cups, and you just shove it in, plunk it down, and there's all kinds of different flavors. Like, she had like Twinkie flavored coffee in it. Think what you will, it tasted great. And
Dunkin' Donuts now sells a Twinkie flavored coffee in a bottle, and I would try to make it, I think, but I bet the Twinkie would just kind of look weird floating around in the coffee. I love the different flavors and stuff, but I always thought those machines were a little wasteful. Like, I don't like having to open a, you know, a plastic thing, get my coffee, throwing that out every time. It just seems awful wasteful. So
definitely wasteful, but it is convenient.
Best feature on my espresso maker is the steamer, dude. I steam my coffee afterwards, and it foams up, and I get it so it, like, the foam's like a foot over the cup. Wow. As far as I can before it falls over, and it is so good, man.
Nice.
So good.
Yeah, and I'm still on that kick we talked about before of mixing various flavors of ice cream into my coffee. And
another good,
like, not only to sweeten it, but to cool it down immediately so that I can drink it. Because I want my coffee. I want it now. I don't want it 25 minutes later when it's ready to drink. So you put some ice cream in there. And my latest favorite is Crazy Cookie Dough by Bluebell. It's like cake batter flavored ice cream with sugar cookie dough in it.
Wow.
Yeah. It is fantastic.
My favorite one to buy is I like just like the coffee with that. I won't say the name of the place, but you'll probably know it. It's got the vanilla sweet cream, and it's so good. It's almost like ice cream, really. But it stays like kind of a tight, foamy kind of. That stuff's great too.
Good stuff, man. Good stuff. Folks. Yeah, buy us a coffee. Buymeacoffee.com/ifthappens. We appreciate it. And we will put our ice cream in accordingly. Absolutely. And let's see. What else we got going on? Check out, dude, the Fringe FM website is, you know, over at the fringe.fm is coming along quite nicely. All kinds of new features and many, many more new features to come. Super hyped talking with Joe today about all the plans for everything we've got going for the Fringe FM. Not only the website, but the network in general. Lots of cool stuff coming up, folks. Definitely stay tuned to the website and any of your favorite Fringe FM hosts and shows. And lots of cool stuff coming down the pipeline. And also make sure to download the Fringe FM app, available at the Google Play Store and the Apple App Store. And probably the easiest way to listen to Shift Happens or the Jess Rogie Show or Light in the Void or Troubled Minds or whatever you got, whatever you want. Not only does it have the live feed, but they have the most recent played episodes as well. So you can kind of pick and choose what you want to play. It's just you open the app and you push play. It's so simple. It's so nice, and it's free, so go get there while you can. Status, and quick shout out to everybody in the chat rooms here. Dave, what's up, Dave Cruz, Dragon Rose, MJ, and Jess, Eric, Awakening Man, and Daryl, what's happening? The Rocker, what's happening? Notice I didn't say his name. I didn't say his name.
Amazing.
Yeah, I got it now. I think I got it down. And then everybody else in the Fringe FM chat, which, by the way, in case you're new to the show, you're just now tuning in for the first time, we do have a couple of chat rooms, the first of which is over at Spreaker. If you're not familiar with Spreaker, that's okay. Just go to shifthappensradio.com There's an episode player in the middle of the homepage. Click the text message icon under the current live episode, and bam, you're in there. And then the other chat room is over at the Fringe FM Discord. Just go to www.fringe.fm/chat, and you will get an automatic invite into the Fringe FM Discord. And that's just another place to... Either place is great to hang out with fellow audience members, and there's always side conversations going on, and people asking great questions for the guest and for us, and just a great way to interact with the show. So there you go. Totally free. All you gotta do is make a name, and you're in there. It takes about 1 minute. So there you go. And I think later on tonight, we'll probably open up the phone lines at some point, so you'll be able to call in as well. Very much an interactive show we have going on here. And thanks to all of you for interacting. Now, got a couple stuff to bring up, but let's go ahead and bring in our guest first tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Certainly no stranger to this show. He's been on here countless times. And here's another time on the notch. It's our good friend, Theta Healer, paranormal researcher, and radio host of E-Talk TV, the one and only Jeff Rennell. What's happening, Jeff?
How is everybody doing tonight? It's a privilege to be back on here. Thank you guys for inviting me again. Looking forward to it. How's everybody doing?
Great. Been meaning to get a hold of you to just to talk etalk.tv, which I don't know if you're up for discussing that at all, but I'm always up for the updates on it, and to also, you know, kind of get into the discussion about a big show I've got coming up on etalk.tv. I can't wait.
Awesome. Yeah, no, I'm looking forward to it as well. And yeah, thanks for asking about that. We're looking forward to having a big marathon coming up October 22nd and 23rd. It's going to be our haunted marathon, kind of to launch our new radio station that we have over at eTalk. We're now running 24/7 with eTalk Radio. And so that's been a nice addition. You know, I mean, this year has been really great to us over here at eTalk. It's been growing, I want to say slowly, but it actually has grown pretty fast this year. And we keep getting some nice additions. But I also am really proud, too, because the team I'm working with, Josh Carpenter, DJ, a.k.a. DJ Blue, and of course Dave Cruz and Gigi, you've been a lot of help as well too to some of the things that we've been doing here at eTalk. But yeah, we started a radio station, and so now we're gonna start doing the marathon on the 22nd and 23rd, and JP is definitely going to be a big part of it. He's going to actually finish up the night on the 22nd with his show Reperception, which I'm very excited to listen to, man. I mean, I can't tell you how much I love your show. It is a blast to listen to. I can't wait to get some new episodes in there as well, too. I've kind of listened to the ones we have in there quite a bit, but I tell you what, I still enjoy listening to them every time. You know, the one with the guy with the flat earth stuff, I mean, that show, just love that one all every time.
It's an epic show. It really is. It was nerve-wracking, and I think it was palpable. I think the audience feels that, like, oh, boy, like, what's going to happen? There's a little bit of tension on that one.
You know,
I've got a great guest, by the way, a good friend of mine, and we're already starting to talk about the show for the 22nd, so we're hyped up for it.
Nice.
Well, you're on from 10 to 12 Pacific time in the p.m., so you're finishing it off. For Saturday. So yeah, if you want to share with the audience members some of the things that you're going to talk about and who you're bringing on, I would love it, because I don't even think I really know who you're bringing on yet.
Yeah, it's just a buddy I know. I call him King Style, and he and I, just one of the few people I've met along the way where he and I just really connect on our philosophies. And a lot of times I'll go at meeting people with maybe things I don't know, or I'm maybe my kind of general outlook is way different from that person. So just so we're not always agreeing on everything. But in this case, we do. We agree on most things, and it actually is a total benefit. And so we're just going to get into it all, man. We're going to have a whole – we're going to narrow it down because right now the scope is, you know, 2 hours. We got to whittle that down. But I think we could do easily a 4 or 5 hour show if we really went for it.
No, I'm sure you could. I mean, you're amazing. You really are as a host, man. I can't say enough. I really like the way you ask questions with your guests. I mean, you two kill it here on Shift Happens every Friday night. There's no doubt about it. But JP, I mean, you're a force to be reckoned with when you're by yourself as a host. I mean, you really do a great job, and every now and then you bring your woman in. Isn't that correct? And
Hey,
she's a force too, man. It's like, don't mess with her because she'll turn the tables on you, man. It's great. I absolutely love the show. And you know, I'm looking forward to your show on the marathon. And I got to say, man, I've been blessed. I've been blessed the whole time I've got welcomed into the UFO community when I first met Brad. And I've been introduced to some amazing people. And so I've actually accumulated quite a few great shows on eTalk.tv. And one I really want to talk about is Brett Luter, man. I mean, we got the Brett Luter show, and Brett Luter is killing it, man. I mean, he's bringing in some amazing guests. You know, he's an author, journalist, all that, and just, he's amazing. And so, like with your show, JP, Reperception, Brett Luter, we have Vivian Chavez, Arterian Hybrid Healer, and her co-host, Jeff Dumas, with the Infinite Star Connection. We have Dave Cruz and Russ Bailey bringing in the Shift Happens. And I mean, they kill it every Sunday night. They've just had a couple of really, really good shows with Brad Olson. They just interviewed Jason Quitt last week. I was lucky enough to be invited to co-host with them. And that was a wonderful show.
That was a great show.
So, yeah, I mean, Jason's amazing. I kept hearing about Jason from you, Gigi. And Jason was just absolutely amazing. I mean, I was in awe, basically, when Dave asked me, hey, you got any questions, Jeff? I'm like, what do you mean? I'm still listening to what this guy has to say. He's just so fascinating. So, you know, I mean, with eTalk, I never imagined that we would be where we're at today at the end. You know, it's been about a year since I started to revise eTalk and just tried to do something a little different with my podcast, and where it's evolved now is absolutely amazing. And to be a part of what it's become, and to be a part of, you know, like your show, JP, you know, to have you, Gigi, part of eTalk as well too, you know, I mean, and just everybody I've been surrounded by and who has helped me put this together has just been amazing, absolutely amazing. And so I'm really looking forward to the marathon we're going to be doing. Dave Cruz is bringing in Nathan Gill. Is that, do you know, is that his name? Demonologist, I believe he is. But I know Dave's had him on before, and he's an amazing guest. I've heard the interview a couple times. And so Dave's bringing him in for the marathon. Brett Luter, I can't wait to hear his. He's actually bringing on the pastor and another gentleman, I forget, but they're all involved in this story of Anton LaVey, the father of the Church of Satan. Okay. They were basically using his daughter as a sacrifice, and when his daughter escaped from that, or basically they left her for dead, they she wasn't cooperating, and so they basically left her for dead and beat her and tortured her and all this stuff. She ended up at this church where this pastor's at, okay? They didn't know who she was. They helped nurse her back to health. When they found out who she was, then before they actually even knew who she was, it came out on the news that they had found this girl, at off of this river. And so, of course, Anton LaVey and his henchmen knew who it was because they left her there to die. And so they knew where the daughter, his daughter was at before the pastor knew who his daughter was. And so Anton LaVey started to attack the church and was trying to get his daughter back, and they wouldn't give her back. And so they were being satanically attacked, ritually attacked and everything. And it's an amazing, amazing story. And this pastor talks about how he never really believed in possession before. You know, I mean, he understood what he was learning, you know, when he was in, you know, Bible school or wherever he went to. But he had a new awakening to it and had to deal with it in a whole new way with battling Anton LaVey and the Church of Satan over his daughter. But this church and this pastor feels like they helped kill Anton LaVey, which Anton LaVey died the night before. So Halloween Eve, he died the night before Halloween. And this church feels like they helped basically kill him by defeating him through all of his ritual and satanic acts. And it's just an amazing story. So Brett's going to bring these two on for his guest for the marathon. And so really looking forward to it. I mean, you guys are nailing it out of the park, man. I'm so happy to have you, JP, part of the network, and everybody else that's been, you know, so willing to be there. But yeah, we're looking forward to the marathon on the 22nd and 23rd. I'm not sure who my guest will be yet, but we'll definitely be having some fun there as we live stream. So
nice. So not to change subjects, but I'm going to change the subject.
Well, we've got about a minute and a half.
Oh, never mind then. Well, yeah, I'll just throw it out there. The Rock, I just said his name, but The Rocker has a Bigfoot. He has a Bigfoot story. And I just happen to know that Jeff Rennell has a Bigfoot story. So maybe when we get back from the break, you can tell it. And I wonder if they're different.
Yeah, and in fact, we had The Rocker and his brother and his father and maybe even another relative. We did a whole Shift Happens episode about their family experience. This was probably 2019, something like that. And very interesting case, and I've talked with The Rocker in person in even more detail about his experience, and that's one of those, because sometimes I'm on the fence about I'm not on the fence about Bigfoot itself. Like, I know, like, I believe every culture has their own story and their own name for the same entity. They're obviously not talking about nothing at all. But some of the evidence that gets put forth is just bitch-ass nothing. Which is unfortunate because it turns a lot of people off of the subject. But there is some good evidence out there. And when I hear somebody like The Rocker, who I know very well and I trust everything he says, you know, and his whole family came on and described the same experience, you know, stuff like that, plus what happened with Eric and John Polk out there that got Eric on his whole Bigfoot kick that he's still on right now, and then having guys like Duke Sullivan, who, by the way, is coming on the show in the next couple of weeks, once again, you know, just the more you explore, the more you realize, like, hey, like, there's something going on here. And so, yeah, maybe we'll get into some Bigfoot stuff when we come back. And with that, we've got a boogie right very now to our commercial break. Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to Shift Happens here for The Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our co-host, JP.
Oh!
Yes, and we're here tonight with Theta Healer, paranormal researcher, and host of eTalk TV, Jeff Rennell. And we'll be back here in just a few short commercially minutes. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy, Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods, 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
Tired of talking about the weather? No shift. Well, Shift Happens is here to fulfill your desires. As you reach that point in life where you crave tantalizing conversation about reality, ufology, the occult, and the conspiracies within, while simultaneously finding yourself desperately in need of your very own theme music, which we've got plenty of that too. So be sure to tune in to Shift Happens every Friday night from 7 to 9 Pacific, right here on The Fringe FM. Because the weather sucks, and you need some theme music.
Musicians experience a lot of frustration with music marketing and promotion. They have no idea how to get their music heard, and they're spending hours sending emails, making phone calls, and hitting up their friends to promote them. With our industry-powered digital marketing platform, we can set up your media plan in minutes. Our team will automatically distribute your music across all the best channels, so you can focus on actually making the music. Submit your music today on our website at mymusicpromoter.com. That's mymusicpromoter.com.
Thousands of people are having paranormal experiences with ghosts, demons, shadow people, dogmen, Bigfoot, and more. Their stories need to be told, and they are being told. Dark Waters, the renowned storyteller, invites you to join at IamDarkWaters.com. For just a few dollars a month, you can listen to some of the most hair-raising and compelling stories on the planet. You'll have access to real-life stories told by Dark Waters. Thousands of hours of content. Their encounters are being told, and told by the best, at IamDarkWaters.com. Listen to stories like The Rabbit Man, The Dogman Encounter in Silas, Alabama, The Man with No Face, The Other Woman, A Day Ahead of the Devil, Dogman Murder in Hurricane Ida, even a story of someone trying to kill a dogman, Louisiana Water Demon Stories. Sign up today and become a member at IamDarkWaters.com. That's IamDarkWaters.com.
Have you suffered in silence or experienced stress from a paranormal experience? Even if it happened 20 years ago, when thinking or talking about it today still makes you feel sick to your stomach or makes your heart beat faster, or you suddenly can't breathe. Maybe you even feel those old familiar signs of a panic attack trying to reach the surface. You could have unprocessed emotional responses. Those reactions of terror and trauma are no different than living through a horrible assault, childhood abuse, or a terrible car accident. It can be nearly impossible to find help. The very instance of seeing a ghost or encountering a cryptid could be clinically described as seeing or hearing things that aren't there. You could be considered psychotic, or at best, you're just not taken seriously. Out of a growing mountain of research, the National Institute for Integrative Healthcare showed that 8 out of 10 veterans who completed just 6 one-hour EFT sessions no longer tested positive for PTSD. If you've had paranormal trauma, you can contact Metaphorical Archaeology by calling 214-995-3754. Again, that's 214-995-3754. For a discreet consultation.
What are you doing late nights? Join me, Jess Rogie, the host of The Jess Rogie Show. We have a new show title and a new time slot. Become part of the show by calling in and joining in on the conversation. We'll discuss a wide variety of topics, including everything from consciousness, conspiracies, current events, fringe topics, pop culture, and so much more. Let's see where the night takes us. Join us live 5 nights a week, Monday through Friday at 11 p.m. Pacific, 2 a.m. Eastern. Right after Lighting the Void with Joe Roop on KTLK Digital Broadcasting, The Fringe FM.
say, I really wanna be in LA.
And we are back. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, for the Fringe FM, you are listening to Shift Happens here. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our co-host, JP.
Hey there, I'm back. I'm definitely here, right? Yeah, check, check.
Yep, he's actually here. He's actually here. And tonight, we have Theta Healer and paranormal researcher and host of eTalk TV, Jeff Fresnel, a good friend of the show. He's been on many times, and he's here once again. Now, so, I was going to say something, but forget that. So right before the show, during the pre-talk, there was, Jeff, you were mentioning some new Bigfoot evidence that is apparently a big thing going around right now. What was this whole story you were talking about?
I don't know how, I think it's about a year old maybe, or getting close to a year old. I know it's new to me. Eric turned me on to it, I don't know, a few weeks ago, but I've been super, super busy. So I pulled up the report and looked at it a little bit. So that's about all I know about it. But it's called the Katchen Report. Have you heard of that at all?
No, I haven't.
No.
So basically, let me go and see if I can pull this up. Okay. It's the Katchen Project, or Katchen Project. I don't know, I'm terrible with English, as everybody knows. So, but basically what they did is for 5 years long, they studied the DNA, and they found this lady, Dr. Melba S. Kitchum, who basically studies DNA and had studied the samples that they had collected for over 5 years. It is a peer-reviewed study, so that's definitely credit right there. But what this review says is that not only does Bigfoot exist, but what the DNA samples show is that it is a hybrid cross of modern Homo sapiens with an unknown primate species.
Interesting. Interesting.
That means it's a part of your brother's instance.
Yeah. And
It's a very interesting study. Eric sent me a thing with the guy that was on Coast to Coast about it. And so I listened to the program, and then I pulled this up here and started to read through it. But sure enough, it's a 5-year study. It says that...
Now, was this the case that originated from a David Pilates 411 case? Missing persons case?
No, I'm not sure, because I've heard that name before, and I'm not sure if that name goes to this.
Okay. Yeah, because I heard something very similar. In fact, I think Dave was telling me about it. Yeah, David Pilates, missing 411. He's got the... He goes on Coast to Coast all the time with George Knapp, usually.
I think actually that is who was talking about it. Yeah, because they mentioned the 411 and stuff. But yeah, it is very interesting. What else was I just going to say a second ago? I forget.
You can count on me to throw you off your curve. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Sorry, I was...
I know what I was going to say. So what this report kind of shows, if this is accurate, the Native American stories always was that it was a cursed human, Bigfoot. And so their tradition, a lot of the stories that go back there, their traditions are, is that a race of beings came, like a Native American race, and they were super beautiful, super amazing, but they also had the ego that went along with it and just thought they were better than everybody else. So the gods came down and cursed them and made them the ugly humans. And that's basically what some of the Native American tribes, their traditions talk about. So this kind of falls in line with that, which is pretty interesting as well, too.
Yeah, well, for sure.
Your brothers and sisters are out there in the forest waiting for you to go find them.
Yeah, and... yeah, I wonder if somebody was so inclined to reproduce with one of these, if that would, like, would that even work? You know, maybe get a cultist who wants to start a whole new species to take over the world, hook up with Bigfoot real quick, you know, see what pops out. Maybe it's the next race.
What Star was saying is that they actually were mating with some of the Native Americans and stuff.
Exactly. Yeah.
And that what he was also saying, you reminded me of this when you were talking about that, that they actually have done studies too and removed the hair. They have taken like sketch artists and had them remove the hair off of the faces of... the Bob Gimmel one, the actual photo of that one there, they removed the hair and exposed what the face would probably look like. I mean, who knows if it's for sure, but sketch artists are usually pretty good and accurate. But most of the sketches that they had the facial hair removed, most of the faces look like Native American faces, even the Bob Gimmel one, or Gimmel.
Oh, you mean the... Okay. Yeah, interesting. Interesting. And, what do you... Because I'm still surprised, you know, like I said earlier, every culture around the world talks about this thing. So there's obviously something to it. But, I mean, obviously there's this new evidence we just talked about, but... it's weird how, like, there's great testimonial stories and eyewitness stories, you know. But yeah, like you mentioned, you know, the Patterson-Gimli footage, or Gimbel footage, rather. You know, there's a couple of things about it that can be dismissed. Not that I dismiss them, but just in general can be dismissed, so it's not taken. Like, it's almost the smoking gun. It's almost a smoking gun. It's only really the only part that most people kind of say, like, wait, what about is the bottom of the foot. There's only a couple of frames where you see it, but if you actually look at it, it sure does look like the bottom of a sole of a shoe. And, but I think we had Bart Catino on the show one time. And he had an explanation for why the feet would look that way. I can't recall it in my terms, but I do remember at the time thinking, like, okay, that could be it, you know, just based on the...
You know how your foot can get all dry and cracked up, and, right. You know, it starts to look all white. Maybe theirs do because they walk barefooted all the time. I don't know. I have issues with that video. I just don't think the facial hair looks that real to me, but I'm still on the fence. I actually was watching a video of Bob Gimmel today, a documentary he did that I just picked up at the Phenomicon conference a few weeks back. And, I mean, Bob seems like a really, you know, seems like a good, honest guy and stuff, so... I mean, I'm still on the fence about the video because even though he seems that way and he seems like he believes in Bigfoot, and I think you could still believe in Bigfoot, still be that type of guy, but who's to say that you didn't hoax something, especially back then? I mean, the video is pretty impressive, but there are certain things. I just don't think the facial hair looks right. It just seems so full everywhere in the face, and then very clear at the eyes. And to me, that, you know, that just seems like a mask that would be made back then. But that's just me. I'm still on the fence with it and trying to learn more about it. I'm new to all the Bigfoot stuff and trying to really research it. There's a lot of things that fascinate me and a lot of things I have a lot of questions about. You know, is it an interdimensional being? And if it's an interdimensional being, why all the structures? Have any questions on that or any answers on that?
Well, I wonder, well, there's always the Mitch Hedberg observation of, you know, he was like, I think Bigfoot is blurry. That's the problem. It's not the photographer's fault. There is a large out-of-focus monster out there roaming the countryside. And that's extra scary to me.
And that's great. That is great. You know, we live in a time where everything's HD, and if I can't get a, at very least, a picture of something in HD quality, I have to throw it out as evidence for anything. I really do. I just, it's really hard for me to accept on any level. So yeah. All you Bigfooters, convince me. Come at me, brah!
Yeah, see, the that's one thing with, like, it's like with Bigfoot, the burden of proof is still on the Bigfoot people. Whereas one thing that's changed is the UFO stuff. It's like now the burden of proof is on the Pentagon. Like they're involved now, and the military. In fact, there was this, if you guys heard about the racetrack UFOs, so they're called. A bunch of information came out about this over the last several days. And, okay, it looks like Eric's going to call in later and lay down some Bigfoot boogie.
Are we talking Eric talk here?
Yeah, we might. Yeah, he might be calling in a little bit. But have you guys heard about these racetrack UFOs?
I didn't hear about it, but I didn't look into it at all yet.
Yeah, I have not.
So between a period of August through the end of September of this year, these pilots that were flying from Honolulu back to Los Angeles or whatever part of Hawaii that you, wherever the airport, you know, Hawaii to Los Angeles, and them along, there's a total of 12 pilots that were all in the air around this area in commercial aircraft, all communicating with each other. It's all recorded. You can hear it all. And they're all telling each other, like, hey, are you seeing this? Like, and they're all describing the same thing. And the interesting part is the most common thing that was said is they seem to be coming from and orbiting around the bottom right star of the Big Dipper. And there's several different pieces of footage that come from the pilots and the and you know, the captain and his co-pilot and even stewardess and everything else. But, you know, it's interesting because if you just look at the footage alone, I mean, that could be anything. That could be me zooming my iPhone in my cat bowl, you know, and shining a light real quick. You know, it doesn't really prove much, but when you see, and I guess one point I was getting to is, you know, JP was saying, you know, like, show me some clear ass footage, you know, and and everybody says about UFOs, like, everybody's got a video camera on their phone, like, why don't we have good shots? It's like, have you tried film? Like, your phones are not designed to film at the sky at night. It's just not, like, take any star. Just look at the star, look at how it looks to you, and then hold your phone up. I don't care what phone you have. You could have the newest Galaxy 73000, right? You hold your phone up and you film it. It doesn't look anywhere near as accurate as what you see with your human eye. So that's a legitimate thing to consider when it comes to having a smoking gun for UFO videos, if that makes any sense. But then when you have...
Oh, yeah, and then there's a huge problem, too, where if you're trying to film, especially with your phone, and trying to zoom in on a speck in the sky and zoom in into it to see if it's a UFO or not, because I actually had a friend just like several weeks ago to a month ago that seemed to have caught a UFO right in the middle of the day on Saturday out here in Salt Lake City, right above the city. And as she zooms in, she actually zoomed in really good, but it's so shaky, it's really hard to tell certain things on it, you know, and to really get a good idea of what it is. But it, you know, it's hard to hold your phone onto something like that. So I agree with you there.
And also, the other thing that people don't realize that I never really considered until it became a problem in my own experiences is how fast these experiences happen. Once you see something that should not exist, you are so blown away, the last thing you're thinking about is trying to reach into your phone and get footage of it. You are shocked, and you're just staring like Google-eyed, like, duh, duh, like, just trying to understand what you're seeing. But some people have seen enough things to where they're ready for it, which I think I would consider myself that now. Like I've got, like, I'm already, especially, you know, when you go out with someone like John Polk or what have you, and you know you're going to see UFOs, like, you've got your shift ready, you know? And
brings up a new question with the whole Bob Gimbel stuff on catching the Bigfoot. So they're on horse. They're 30, 40 miles deep into the forest in a wash.
I think it's Gimli, by the way, but yeah.
Gimmel,
Gimmel. Is it Eric corrected us earlier?
I think it's Gimmel.
Might be Gimmel.
I got it on a poster right there. But anyhow,
yeah.
But anyhow, they're on horseback going through a creek deep in the forest when they supposedly come across this Bigfoot that's just hanging out in the creek. No Bigfoot has ever just casually walked on by when nobody else is trying to get a footage of it. And nowadays it's so much easier to pull out a camera and take a picture than it was back then. Oh, supposedly, yeah. Patterson had a camera right next to him at his disposal, but still, you're going to tell me that they're riding on horseback, they come across a Bigfoot in the creek, and that Bigfoot just casually cruises on by, letting them have the time to get off the horse, to get the camera, to get that footage.
Yeah, very suspect.
I mean, I want to see all the footage to be able to analyze that better than just the clip, the famous clip we all see.
Yeah.
I'd like to see the whole thing. But to me, you know, even if you do see this stuff all the time, this is what you're there for, the money shot.
Right.
Dude, you have to be pretty poised to be able to do, to get off the horse quick enough, to get your camera out, and to get this footage without scaring, disturbing a Bigfoot and making it leave that premise pretty damn quick. And there's two of these guys. That's yeah. pushing it to me. I just don't know if I can go there.
Especially considering, because that was in the 60s. Do you know who had a video camera in the 60s? Nobody. Nobody had a video camera in the 60s. Unless you were making Hollywood movies.
Well, they're not as easy as they are to operate today. They're definitely not as easy to operate.
Yeah, you
need so many more special conditions to operate those cameras back then than now. Yeah, that's where it's just like, I mean, again, Bob seems like such a great guy on the documentary, and as he's talking, he's telling his life, and it's great to hear, but still, I mean, when he talks about the actual experience, it's just there's certain things that I can't see happening. I mean, that had to be the perfect storm, and it had to be a Bigfoot that was just like, oh, whatever. Maybe the Bigfoot was stoned out in the woods and just was casually, you know, yeah. What's up, dudes? Yeah. And trying to, you know, just cruise out of there. I don't know, but freaking, it doesn't seem like it adds up to me. I mean,
yeah,
he was eating, seems great,
eating those shrooms, but I see. I have a a hard line no against all the Bigfoot mythology. And it's strange because I couldn't feel any more differently about UFOs. I've actually seen with my own two eyes through a telescope absolutely unexplainable things, 100%, you know, foreign to anything I've ever thought I would see. Just like a little thing moving with intention across the moon. Just things shooting off into space and fragmenting. And I mean, I've seen all this stuff and it's like mind blowing. Like it looked like a video game when I was watching it. I just like that was the first imagery that, you know, came into my mind. So I don't know. But when it comes to the Bigfoot thing, I'm like, come on, I need something, you know?
Yeah.
You know,
We've got about 30 seconds.
Oh yeah. Here we go.
Okay. So just really quick, like I'm with you there. I mean, I've seen them. I've captured enough stuff on camera now with UFOs and everything. I've experienced interesting stuff with Eric, and Eric can back it up when he gets on here in a second. The only question I have is when me and Eric went out into the forest with this guy, Brad, and there was about, I think, 8 of us out there at this time, and Raw was with us as well, Arcturus Raw.
Nice.
My only thing with that is we went out there, he took us straight to these structures, which I'm okay with and stuff, because if he knew it was out there, it was out there. But we heard that Bigfoot about 20 minutes into this, and I've asked Eric about this. I'm like, what do you think that this guy might have stashed somebody out in the forest because he knew where he was taking us? So what if this guy would stash somebody out there and made a Bigfoot noise when we got out there? The only thing that makes me go, maybe that didn't happen, is because Raw captured sounds as well. About 30 to 40 minutes later, when he was away from all of us by himself in the cars, he captured some more sounds that were definitely way different than ours. Same type of sounds, but just longer and more drawn out. So I want to question everything because, you know, I want to know. I want to know myself.
Yeah,
so.
And that brings up a very good story that I'm going to bring up when we come back. And then we'll get to Eric, who has called in here, but unfortunately we just simply have to go to commercial break right now. So let's just go ahead and do that and get that out of the way. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for the Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our co-host, JP. And we're here tonight with Jeff Rennell, paranormal researcher, theta healer, and host of eTalk TV. We'll be back here in just a few short commercially minutes, and we will also be joined by Eric Awakening Man, a.k.a. Eric the Adventurer. All right, we'll see you in a few minutes, folks. Hoy there, it's Gigi from Shift Happens, and you're shaking some conversational tail feather to the Fringe FM.
Thousands of people are having paranormal experiences with ghosts, demons, shadow people, dogmen, Bigfoot, and more. Their stories need to be told, and they are being told. Dark Waters, the renowned storyteller, invites you to join at IamDarkWaters.com. For just a few dollars a month, you can listen to some of the most hair-raising and compelling stories on the planet. You'll have access to real-life stories told by Dark Waters. Thousands of hours of content. Their encounters are being told and told by the best at IamDarkWaters.com. Listen to stories like The Rabbit Man, The Dog Man Encounter in Silas, Alabama, The Man with No Face, The Other Woman, A Day Ahead of the Devil, Dogman Murder in Hurricane Ida,
Even a story of someone trying to kill a dogman. Louisiana Water Demon Stories. Sign up today and become a member at IamDarkWaters.com. That's IamDarkWaters.com.
Hey there, this is Jess, host of The Jess Rogie Show, and you're listening to KTLK Digital Broadcasting Fringe FM.
Musicians experience a lot of frustration with music marketing and promotion. They have no idea how to get their music heard, and they're spending hours sending emails, making phone calls, and hitting up their friends to promote them. With our industry-powered digital marketing platform, we can set up your media plan in minutes. Our team will automatically distribute your music across all the best channels, so you can focus on actually making the music. Submit your music today on our website at mymusicpromoter.com. That's mymusicpromoter.com.
Have you suffered in silence or experienced stress from a paranormal experience? Even if it happened 20 years ago, when thinking or talking about it today still makes you feel sick to your stomach or makes your heart beat faster, or you suddenly can't breathe. Maybe you even feel those old familiar signs of a panic attack trying to reach the surface. You could have unprocessed emotional responses. Those reactions of terror and trauma are no different than living through a horrible assault, childhood abuse, or a terrible car accident. It can be nearly impossible to find help. The very instance of seeing a ghost or encountering a cryptid could be clinically described as seeing or hearing things that aren't there. You could be considered psychotic, or at best, you're just not taken seriously. Out of a growing mountain of research, the National Institute for Integrative Healthcare showed that 8 out of 10 veterans who completed just 6 one-hour EFT sessions no longer tested positive for PTSD. If you've had paranormal trauma, you can contact Metaphorical Archaeology by calling 214-995-3754. Again, that's 214-995-3754 for a discreet consultation.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
Fringe FM, this is Shift Happens. I am your host, Gigi, along with our co-host, JP.
I just tweeted at Shift Happens. I said, halftime, Rennell 1, Shift Happens 0.
All right. Good deal. Fair enough. And speaking of which, our guest tonight is Jeff Rennell from eTalk TV and Theta Healer and Paranormal Researcher. And so let's get right back to where we left off. I think we have, is Eric? Yep, we've got Eric as well. I was just going to share a quick story that over the break I realized I probably shouldn't name names and name places in this story. But let's just say a big radio owner in this community that everybody here knows who he is spent a lot of money to go to this certain place that was known for these fancy crystal caves and caverns that they have there. But their tourism started slowing down. So they decided to add Bigfoot experiences to the list. Like, hey, come out here. You might hear some Bigfoot. And so these guys went out there. They had their own cameras and their own night vision ready to go. And what they found out was these people that was previously a perfectly fine organization. Like, they just, there was nothing sketchy about it. They just showed people the crystal mines. And it was a fun time. But when it came to the Bigfoot stuff, they caught on their own night vision cameras that they didn't expect them to have. And they filmed people squatted up on the tops of edges and throwing rocks down and making noises and be like, and then the guy, after they would do that on cue, the guide would be like, oh, you hear that? That was a Bigfoot. And it was such a big fault, like this big paranormal radio organization was going to do a whole conference over there. And then after they saw that they got bullshitted like that, they canceled the whole thing. And they even lost a lot of money, too. Like, they had money invested that they couldn't get back, and they still was like, dude, you're full of shit, and we're not going to be any part of it, even if it costs us money. And I wish I could name names. I'm sure most of you probably, at least half of you probably know what I'm talking about exactly. I just don't feel comfortable saying names. But it's people that we all know. But anyway, just another example. But that's not to say, you know, at the same time, there's UFO tour researchers. You know, like they'll have a clever guy on the side of a mountain shooting up a laser. Or whatever, you know, trying to point something up in the sky, you know, like that's the same stuff has been done with UFO sightings, but and I'm not talking about my friends, because, you know, like, dude, just go out with John Polk. That shift is legit. He'll hand you the goggles, he'll point it out, he'll show you. There's some magic happening in Sedona. But there is other places where there's no magic happening that people create their own magic. So if they're doing that with UFOs, they're doing that with Bigfoot too, I guarantee you. And that was basically my whole point.
They do it in the spiritual world as well too, unfortunately, you know.
Yeah, I guess there's analogous respects to that in pretty much every field of investigation that we talk about on these shows. There's examples of exactly that, so that can't really discount anything on its own. It's just something to consider. But now, okay, with that out of the way, okay, I see we have some questions from both chat rooms. That's great, thank you. We will get to those as soon as we can. But first and foremost, who has been waiting very patiently is our good friend Eric Awakening Man, aka Eric the Adventurer. He's here tonight with us on Shift Happens. What's happening, Eric?
Eric.
Gigi. Right on, brothers. I just want to compliment Gigi. You know, we all go through our ups and downs in life, and you know, I think he's created a show, and it's evolved into a really good show. And Jeff's a good friend of mine, and I'm psyched about his E-Talk Radio. I'm going to do the show called E-Talkin'. I'm going to talk mostly Bigfoot and other stuff. But and then JP, you know, JP kind of inspired me to call in, because he kind of showed a flash of skepticism about the Bigfoot story. So yes, that kind of that inspired me. So I look forward to, once again, going back into the time bubble with the Debbie Daly days and debunking debunking JP's vision of Bigfoot.
Make me believe. I don't even have a poster that says I want to believe in Bigfoot. But maybe I do.
Let me just say this. I mean this 100%. No bullshit. I've had a half a beer and a shot of JD, Jack Daniels, on behalf of my friend Jeff Brunell, who, by the way, guys, This dude has got the baddest mother shit in the house on the baddest mountain, looking at the baddest Wasatch alien base mountain. And Jeff, why have you not talked about this, Jeff? We both have filmed lights on your mountain less than a quarter mile from your house. So let's forget Bigfoot for a minute. Jeff, talk about that, because that's a real phenomena that's occurring.
He's trying to keep it on the down low.
Wow.
Still trying to figure out what's
swinging, man.
I'm just trying to figure out what's out there, because truthfully, there's just nothing out there. When you look at the mountain during the day, there's nothing there, dude. There's no campsites. There's nothing there. It's just a big, huge granite mountain, you know, and yeah, there's these lights that keep appearing, periodically throughout the night and stuff. Eric, you know, I've seen them before Eric mentioned them, but I just never thought twice of it. You know, it's like, what is there going to be something outside of my house? Yeah, right. And so I never thought twice of it, but Eric, you know, he's up, or, you know, he's usually up a little bit before me and stuff. And so about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, he has my blinds pulled open, looking out the window, taking photos of these lights out there. And sure enough, yeah, throughout the night, you're going to see there's, you know, red and white lights that show up on this mountain. And so, not sure what they are yet and what's going on there, but it's definitely very interesting. And Eric's got some pretty cool photos of it. One guy on Twitter, what did he superimpose that one, Eric? And that was a pretty interesting one. It actually looked like Gigi might have been behind the light, because there's one that looks like it has rabbit ears.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, this lady who's like deep into this stuff on Facebook, actually. So I posted it on Facebook too, and I don't know how she's doing it, but she was able to zoom in, and maybe she's got some special equipment, but it looks to me like there's some freaking aliens in on that thing. I mean, I filmed it moving twice on two separate occasions. Your filming was amazing, because you got like 2 minutes of films. It shows it red and white blinking in specific spots. And mine that I filmed are in the same general vicinity, but a few times I've seen this light around 5:30, 5:40 in the morning a.m. approximately, moving across left to right, and so I hiked up there. There's no freaking road up there. There's no way you could get an ATV up there. There's no houses. There's no freaking way that's humans up there playing around, in my opinion. I'll bet my life on it. So there's something going on. I'm psyched. I'm looking forward to doing a deeper dive, and I'm psyched that it's so close to Jeff's house, because I think we're going to have a story that is kind of – we're breaking it right now on Shift Happens. And I'm not kidding you. This is going to be a big story one day, I think, because it's not like a – it wasn't a one-shot deal. Three or four nights, mornings, and at night, we've seen these things like multiple times, not just one time. Right, Jeff?
Yeah, really. Eric has captured it, you know, early in the morning, like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning. And Eric was, after Eric had left my house, or actually Eric was still there, but he went up to Pocatello for the conference up there for the weekend and then came back to my house. But while he was gone to Pocatello that weekend, I had come home from work. It was about, I don't know, I'd say 9:30 at night, and there was a red dot out, you know, red light out there. And so I quickly went out and got my cameras as soon as I pulled in, and got my cameras and went out there and filmed it for a while. And it would come on and then shut off for, you know, 4 or 5 minutes, and then come back on for 4 or 5 minutes. But what Eric's saying, yeah, it's definitely no person. That's for sure. Because if it was a flashlight, you know, you would see it kind of strobing and flashing as the person's walking with it. It's a stationary light as it's going. Well, Eric has filmed it moving. I've only seen mine stationary. But because it's so stationary and it's so bright up there at the top of the mountain, you know, it's not a person. It's not a campfire. It's nothing like that, because there's no flicker to it at all. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, one thing I do want to add, there's a lot of chatter in one of the chat rooms. You know, they're all talking about examples of, you know, how, you know, Bigfoot stuff has been hoaxed, whether it's fake footprints or whatever. UFO stuff has been hoaxed with fake light and trickery. And we can name even like ghosts, you know, like paranormal haunted house ghosts have been spoofed and all that. Like, that happens to everything. And I think just human nature.
Dude,
we just have
charlatans everywhere. There's charlatans in our political system.
Exactly.
There's charlatans running our country.
I was going to use the word jackasses. There are jackasses in every single category of community that, for whatever their motivation, want to trick people into believing something that actually is true, but their proof is bullshit. And I think the Bigfoot community has more of these fake spoofers than maybe comparable to the UFO community, probably more so to the, you know, haunted house ghost community. But that's not to, you know, I've seen some shift, and it doesn't matter what you fake or what you make. I can tell you, like, I don't care what you do. Like, I know what I saw. And I think same thing goes with, I believe the same thing goes with, I really trust Eric and John Polk and all their experiences that they've had. Jeff as well, and JP, you know. I mean, I wouldn't have these kind of people on the show otherwise. You know, I guess is what I'm trying to say. So, it is important to, but it is still important to acknowledge which evidence is butchered and slighted, and which ones are actually like just straight up no filter, you know. And
here's the problem. Let me just say this, GT. This is the issue. This has been going on a long time. There are people, for whatever their reasons are, I'm not really sure exactly. They want the attention. They want the fame. They can make a few bucks on the deal, where they basically co-opt the information from true experiencers. In other words, I mean, I could, if I wanted to write a book or make a movie, I could fool everybody if I wanted to. I could put all a bunch of information together and present it in such a way where none of you all would disbelieve me. And if I put a $9.99 price tag on it or a $4.99 price tag on it, people would buy it and I'd make a lot of money. And that's how it works. So you've got these people out there that are basically bastardizing the topic with charlatan bullshit. Sorry, pardon the expression, bullshit, but that's the word I want to use. But so the bottom line is this, is I'm telling you right now, the people I've talked to, and for example, Rick Doty, and I don't give a shit what people say about Rick Doty. The man is legitimate. Forget about Benowitz. Just put that was 40 freaking years ago. Doty is, nobody knows this. He is the best researcher we have alive. He has more contacts. He has better access to information. He had access to files that were classified. We've had conversations. I said, well, can I talk about that? He said, well, don't, you know, the bottom line is this, is I'm convinced Doty had a Bigfoot experience. He told me about a Bigfoot encounter that was in Idaho at a military base that I never heard of about 2 weeks ago. And then just the other day, he told me about a story in Anaheim, Canada, about a forest ranger who had a Bigfoot encounter over a 2-day span. This is not even on the news. This is not even on YouTube. You won't find this information anywhere. But the bottom line is this, is Bigfoot is frickin' real, period.
Yeah, hey, and
you know, one of my favorite authors of all time, Adam Gorightly, lives up in Northern California, Sacramento area, and he's a huge Bigfoot fan, and he writes a lot about it. So, you know, I'm not dead inside. I just need to see some evidence, Eric. And I don't care how loud you yell. I need the proof.
All right, brother, but, I'll tell you what. So,
well, here,
for this really what, quick. Hold on.
You want to travel? Okay. You just sent me. You know how to get a hold of me, JP. Get a hold of me. I'll take
That's
you on
exactly
expedition.
It, Eric.
I'll
That's
turn
what
you
I was going to say, over. Eric. Come Dude, on, JP.
Yeah, JP.
Come on a little adventure with us, JP.
JP can travel. Yeah, okay.
Let's take the shift on the road.
It's officially. Yes, absolutely. It's official. JP is going to go on an upcoming trip with Eric and see some stuff.
I would love it.
I'll say this. I'll offer my place up.
Okay.
The three of you guys come to my place. We'll go out to Burnham. We'll go up to Ashland Forest or the Ashley Forest and go up there and take a look around because, you know, JP, I was like you before until I went on that adventure with Eric and this guy, Brad, which again, who knows? I've said this to Eric before. This guy could have sent somebody up there because we were there 15, 20 minutes when we heard this Bigfoot. So to me, I'm like, okay, this guy could have been planted into the forest and stuff. The only thing that makes me doubt that is Raw picked up footage later on without us. And so unless that guy was still hanging around and did it for Raw's entertainment alone, that makes me go to the side that it was real. But the other thing is when me and Eric and Raw adventured off without these guys afterwards, and we went throughout other parts of this forest, and there were structures and 20, 30-foot trees up in the air that I know no man can do. I'm on the side that something's out there and something's doing something crazy out there. Question then at that point is, are they interdimensional or just here? Because why are they building the structures the way they are?
Yeah, they're interdimensional. They're definitely interdimensional. I would bet money on that. Go ahead, JP.
I'm sorry to cut you off. I see it this way. Eric needs to show me this. You are somewhat of a promoter, Jeff. And I need a third, like a nonpartisan referee that can maybe help us. And I'm feeling that Gigi should be that person.
Yeah, that's me. Yeah. Yeah. And
Gigi, give your mom a call. Gigi, call your mom. Tell her you got a mission. You're on a mission from God. Let her know you need a little help. Get your butt on a plane.
She won't give a shit. I'll have to rely on coffee purchases.
I'll tell you what. I'll call her up. I'll close the deal for you. You know I will.
Dude, honestly, my mom is one of the biggest supporters of this podcast, but she wouldn't even do that. No. But I do want to ask JP, though. So with your reasonable skepticism towards the Bigfoot thing. I mean, we talked about this earlier, but I just want to rephrase it for you. I mean, what do you make of every culture around the world that didn't even know about each other? All describe the same thing. Abominable snowman, Sasquatch, Yeti, Bigfoot. Everybody's got a different name for it. Going back as far as history, do you really think that they're talking about nothing at all? Or do you think that, you know, kind of like the Great Flood? The Great Flood is in every different religion around the world. It's pretty obvious, like, despite their wild religious beliefs that spawned from that, the original spawning point was this Great Flood that every culture around the world documented. And I feel like that's kind of the same thing with Bigfoot. Do you see what I'm saying? And what do you think about what I'm saying?
I hear every word, and the first thing that comes to my mind is dinosaurs, and which I don't believe existed at all. I'm going on the record right now. They never existed, but a man in England, a British royalty member, made the discovery. And how did that word spread of the dinosaurs worldwide is the same kind of concept, the same idea. And I always say that the old tricks are always the best tricks. And that's how I feel Bigfoot, you know, in present day is kind of laid out. And it's,
I'll drag you, you just get on your butt on a plane and fly out there. I'll drive you around. You don't even have to pay for the gas. Matter of fact, I'll get a double room. You don't even have to pay for the hotel. Just, you know, you can buy your own freaking food. I ain't paying for your food, bro.
Right. No, I hear you.
Yeah.
I'm good with that.
But, you know, yeah, no, I'll
pay for your own whiskey too.
I'm about to invest in Bitcoin, and come January, my investment's going to have improved quite a bit, so I'll be able to go at that point.
I think that's a good idea. I have one other option I'd like to pose to everyone, since we have a couple minutes before the break.
Minute and a half.
I just kind of got lucky. I now own a piece of land in Texas.
Nice.
Near Houston. Yeah. And I think that if we can all get there, there's like, I'm going to check it out this coming week, for sure. But I can go almost any time after that. And I'm going to check out, I think it's going to be very, very good view of the sky from where it's at. So
please, I'm going to come on now, Texas.
The downside is
don't bring
Texas.
I'm just going to warn you right now. Keep the weed. If you got any weed, keep it in your trunk. Because if you drive through Texas at seven miles an hour over the speed limit, they'll pull you over and search your car and take your weed, and they'll frick with you.
Nobody else. I'm sure.
I've got a better idea. Don't bring any weed, because even if you're not speeding, they're still going to pull you over because of your California plates.
Yes,
specifically.
Absolutely.
And they're going to search you for any sort. Yeah. That's the only thing wrong still with Texas is the marijuana laws.
I'm not going to Texas, but, I tell you that.
But did you hear the, not to get political, but Biden just straight up announced, like, hey, he's pardoning everybody that has ever been federally criminalized. Oh, Jesus. Been criminalized. He's letting all that shit off the record. And he is highly encouraging every state in the country to do the same, which is, man, for a guy who can't count to three and falls off a bicycle, that's pretty good. That's pretty good.
Biden is a freaking stoner. Him and Bill Clinton used to smoke fat blunts together. Okay, let's just be real.
I hope they did. Yes, I hope so.
On the adrenaline throw now.
I hope so. And I think we have, oh boy, we got to run to a commercial break.
Are you really shocked, Eric, when you think that Adderall is the most prescribed drug in the country? I think it has something to do with Biden, too. You might be onto something there.
Yeah.
I see both sides of the coin. You can flip the coin in the air, and as it's flipping, I put it on pause and go slow motion. I see both sides of the coin. That's why you don't see me signing up for either side, because both sides are bullshit. And they're all propaganda to dumb us down so they continue the manipulation of our minds. But I ain't playing it. Period.
Okay.
Is there a chance that
Hold on. Listen, folks. We are on a tight schedule on the French FM. They're not messing around now. We have to take breaks on time, or else I get in trouble. I'm already going to get in trouble for this one. So we have to take a break right now. It's not my idea. I would rather keep talking, but we had to take a commercial break. So let's take it right now, and let's just jump back in right where we left off when we come back. Sound good? Sounds good. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here. For the French FM, I'm your host, Gigi, along with our co-host, JP. We're here tonight with our guest, Jeff Rennell, and Eric, the explosive awakening man, is here tonight as well. And we'll be back in just a few short commercially minutes. Don't go anywhere.
Tired of going out and having fun on Friday nights? Perfect. Because that's when our show, Shift Happens, airs live every Friday night at 7 p.m. Pacific. That's 9 p.m. Central, right here on The Fringe FM. Get there while you can status.
Listen, as we explore the mysteries of the universe, the unknown, high strangeness, consciousness, and our human potential, Lighting the Void is an eclectic program that strives to ignite the late night with stimulating conversations. Join us on The Fringe FM.
Are you intrigued by Paranormal Talk Radio? You'll love the new Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live. You'll find a great selection of talk shows covering UFOs, ghosts, strange phenomena, and much more. Download the Paranormal Radio app now and start listening to the very best in paranormal talk entertainment, including the network you're listening to right now. The Paranormal Radio app. Free in Google Play and the iOS App Store.
If you suffered in silence or experienced stress from a paranormal experience, even if it happened 20 years ago, when thinking or talking about it today still makes you feel sick to your stomach or makes your heart beat faster, or you suddenly can't breathe, maybe you even feel those old familiar signs of a panic attack trying to reach the surface. You could have unprocessed emotional responses. Those reactions of terror and trauma are no different than living through a horrible assault, childhood abuse, or a terrible car accident. It can be nearly impossible to find help. The very instance of seeing a ghost or encountering a cryptid could be clinically described as seeing or hearing things that aren't there. You could be considered psychotic, or at best, you're just not taken seriously. Out of a growing mountain of research, the National Institute for Integrative Healthcare showed that 8 out of 10 veterans who completed just 6 one-hour EFT sessions no longer tested positive for PTSD. If you've had paranormal trauma, you can contact Metaphorical Archaeology by calling 214-995-3754. Again, that's 214-995-3754 for a discreet consultation.
Musicians experience a lot of frustration with music marketing and promotion. They have no idea how to get their music heard, and they're spending hours sending emails, making phone calls, and hitting up their friends to promote them. With our industry-powered digital marketing platform, we can set up your media plan in minutes. Our team will automatically distribute your music across all the best channels, so you can focus on actually making the music. Submit your music today on our website at mymusicpromoter.com. That's mymusicpromoter.com.
Thousands of people are having paranormal experiences with ghosts, demons, shadow people, dogmen, Bigfoot, and more. Their stories need to be told, and they are being told. Dark Waters, the renowned storyteller, invites you to join at IamDarkWaters.com. For just a few dollars a month, you can listen to some of the most hair-raising and compelling stories on the planet. You'll have access to real-life stories told by Dark Waters. Thousands of hours of content. Their encounters are being told and told by the best at IamDarkWaters.com. Listen to stories like The Rabbit Man, The Dogman Encounter in Silas, Alabama, The Man with No Face, The Other Woman, A Day Ahead of the Devil, Dogman Murder in Hurricane Ida, even a story of someone trying to kill a dogman. Louisiana Water Demon Stories. Sign up today and become a member at IamDarkWaters.com. That's IamDarkWaters.com.
This is Tom Sherman. Down here at Banning College, we're up. We're promoting a blood drop. Oh, shit.
Not guilty. Welcome to the Sound of America. It was like the AM 580. Lay back. The sheep.
Don't be sold to my base!
You cannot be saved.
Follow me in our
good to know that he's walking with me.
Big rock is a weapon.
The devil is a black dog.
Into the fog.
Let him cast the first stone.
Jesus.
And you have fallen into the love that needs to be discerned by the Lord. Hallelujah, y'all. I want to hear a couple of hallelujahs.
Ladies and gentlemen, for the Fringe FM, this is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with our co-host, JP.
Hey there, what's going on?
Yes, and we're here tonight with our guest, Jeff Rennell from eTalk TV. And also joining us is our one and only favorite, Eric Awakening Man, a.k.a. Eric the Adventurer. And,
Hey, guys.
Yeah, you know, you know what's funny, Eric? Is
I was actually trying to get Doty to call in, and he will in the future, but he's packing for a trip. He's going to the United Kingdom to do a presentation this weekend, so... So anyway, we'll arrange that in the future. The Doty's got, you know, Doty's got more information than God.
I bet he does. And you know what? Speaking of Doty, I highly recommend for anybody that's interested in hearing of what Richard Doty has to say. It's very exclusive. There's only one way you can get it. There is a full 3-hour uncut interview between Stephen Greer and Richard Doty. And the only way you can get it is if you buy Unacknowledged on iTunes, which comes with bonus content. One of the bonus contents is a 3-hour interview uncut with Richard Doty. And that is one of the most interesting. I think everybody should see that. I guess is my point.
Well, can I just say one thing real quick, Gigi, that people, if you're going to be a researcher, you can't do it half shift. Bottom line is this, is that there's several levels of intelligence in the intelligence community. You've got the DIA, you've got the CIA, you've got the FBI, you've got, I mean, I can go on and on. There's a lot of them that we don't even know about, but if you can find them, if you want to Google it and figure it out. But the bottom line is this, is that, he has access to information that nobody that I know personally has access to. And he has no agenda, in my opinion. If I thought there was an agenda where he thought that whatever he was telling me or sharing with me had something to do with where he was going to profit financially from, then I wouldn't be bragging about the fact that I think he's legit. People need, I mean, here's the deal. I mean, whatever happened with Benowitz 40 frickin' years ago, he was doing his job. So let me ask you this. If you're a soldier and you're in the war and your job is to shoot the enemy, and then later it comes out in some story that some idiot from the UK makes a movie about that says, oh, this guy shot the enemy. He's a bad person. Well, shit, there's lots of people that are assigned to shoot the enemy. That was their job. Get over it.
Right? Yeah. I mean, that's, you know, you got to think about that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And it is an interesting thing. I'll have my eyes open. Maybe I won't shave in case there's any, you know, Lady Bigfoots.
Yeah. But yeah, no, when it comes to Doty, though.
Shaving strike until you see Bigfoot?
Yes.
So you'll become the Bigfoot eventually.
I'm going to be sick.
Before we go back to Bigfoot, let me just tell you a quick story. So when I was at this Moon Lake talk that Jeff Rennell was at also with Ryan Burns, who's a freaking cool dude, amazing. And what Jeff knows this, what Ryan Burns has managed to accomplish through purchasing property literally next door to Skinwalker Ranch, not down the street, not down the block, literally next door. Jeff knows this. This dude is doing boots on the ground, big time research. It's almost scary. I mean, I don't know that I would do the kind of research that Ryan Burns has done. But for whatever his reasons are, he's chosen that path. And you know what? God bless him for it, because I've learned a lot from him. But the bottom line is this, is that there's a lot going on in Utah. Jeff knows that. A lot going on. Way more going on than most people realize. Right, Jeff?
I didn't realize it when I moved here, but let me tell you, I'm so happy it is here. Because yeah, it's all around, dude, and I'm like centrally located. So
wow,
yeah, it's an amazing place. The more you study, the more you find out, and I'm finding more out from the gold, the treasure hunters here than anybody else. I mean, their stories are absolutely amazing. It's just an amazing place, and with a rich, rich history for thousands of years, if not longer.
And Gigi, there was at the conference, they were talking about the treasure hunters not a conference. It was more of the Moonlight Gathering. It was great. It was like what do they call that? Like an open forum, basically, where people can get up and tell their stories. And I actually was inspired to get up and, for the first time publicly in front of other humans publicly, tell my story. And I've got a YouTube channel that I'll send you guys a link. I don't want to promote it because I don't want a lot of subscribers. I want to keep it on the down low. But the point I'm trying to make is that there's a lot of information out there that most people don't know about. The whole Moon Lake Gathering, I learned so much. And there's guys out there hunting for gold, hunting for treasures. They're digging in the mountains. They're going into caves. This one guy told me a story where him and his friend were in this cave. They were looking for treasure, and a frickin' Bigfoot showed up. They were not Bigfoot researchers. They were not looking for Bigfoot. They were looking for treasure, and a Bigfoot showed up. And the guy's partner that he brought along with him to kind of help out with a lookout, because they were kind of in an area that was kind of probably maybe not totally legit in terms of they didn't have probably permission to be there, I'm assuming. But this guy freaked out. He saw this freaking Bigfoot literally like within a stone's throw away. And he refuses to ever go back there again with this guy, even to look for treasure, that they have evidence the treasure is in the cave. They know it's there. But this one guy, he's trying to find somebody that will go back there with him so they can dig out this treasure. But now that this Bigfoot story's out, they're afraid. So who knows? Maybe Bigfoot's watching over the treasures. Who knows?
Can I cut in?
Dragon, I just wanted to read a comment real fast. Dragon Rose says, it is very easy to stage something to drum up tourism. I know folks in Rachel who joke about doing just that. Not saying there aren't real UFOs. I'll just add in, or Bigfoots, but it's so easy to spoof.
Exactly. That's kind of what
that's true. I agree with that.
Yeah, it's totally kind of what we touched upon briefly earlier. Sorry, hold on. My cat is fucking up everything. I'm effing up everything. But real quick, we do have a caller, and it comes from area code 818. Let's go ahead and take the call. What's up, caller? Who are you, and what are you doing here? What's happening?
It's the Rocker.
The Rocker! Hell yeah. Yes! What's up, Rocker?
Yeah.
The Rocker. How are you guys?
The Rocket Man.
Doing just fantastic. Slightly hungry.
So, you know what?
But good.
Jeff said something very important. If they're building tree structures, why are they interdimensional? They're not. They are not, and I will disagree with anything interdimensional. What we saw when we were out there and what we witnessed as six people, that thing was as solid, not interdimensional. That thing was as clear as day. Well, it was at night, but it scared the crap out of all of us. Period.
Okay, let me just say this real quick, Scott. That here's my current belief is, I think there are certain we'll call them breeds of Bigfoot that for whatever reason they're more here. They're more present in the 3D, where there's also other types of big. They're not all the same. Just like humans aren't all the same. Just like all the ETs. I mean, Clifford Stone said at one point they had documented, I think it was 56 or 57 different ETs. Richard Doty knows for fact, based on his own classified information, that there were four ET races documented that the government knew about. Now, that was in the 80s. So what I'm trying to say is you can't really put Bigfoot in one category. I mean, there's could be many truths about Bigfoot. It's just like there could be many truths about UFOs and many truths about extraterrestrials. You can't put them into one box.
I got you. All I can tell you is what I witnessed. And as a 15-year-old going through that dark, woody area down some Timberland roads, which we shouldn't have been on at that late at night, and here on Forest, what this thing looked like when I first witnessed it was like a man on stilts. That's exactly what I thought. Was like, what the hell is this thing? But it did not run, which is very weird because most Bigfoot people that witness Bigfoot, they hide and they run. This was not elusive. It walked straight down the road towards the car, and we were only doing 5-6 miles per hour at that time. And we were just looking at this thing, and until we started recognizing that this thing was not reality, that's when everybody in the car started really flipping out, really having a hard time, especially the driver who got out of control, and we had to control him down. But what I had witnessed that day was not the fur on this animal was not clean. It was not like, you know, combed and nice, like it was blown dry. This thing was hair matted, clumped together, flied mud all over the thing. The face, now this is what really gets me. When I looked up at this thing, and I'm telling you, like at least 10 foot tall, it was massive. This thing was dragging its legs, and it looked like it was crippled. I don't know what happened with that perspective, but the face of this thing was more human than it was ape. And that's what really freaked me out, except the eyes of this thing was more elongated, and it looked kind of like dog's eyes. And that's what really trips me out. It haunts me to this day, and I'm trying to figure out what the hell we all saw. I want an answer.
You know, he makes a good point there, too, because when you listen to the stories of hunters out there that have run across Bigfoot and have had them in the lines of their scopes, they say they can't shoot them because it looks too human-like, especially when they see them in the eyes. And so they haven't been able to shoot them because they feel like they're shooting one of their own. So he makes a great point there. Some of the things with the interdimensional things that I just want to talk about really quick, if I can, just things that have gone through my mind. So if they are interdimensional and they are making these structures, maybe their home is here on Earth. And, you know, I know from studying spirituality and my ideas and what I believe interdimensional would be taking your conscious into other dimensions and moving. And if you're highly evolved, that you can maybe then take your physical form with you into other dimensions, but mainly you're taking your consciousness. So if Bigfoot is maybe Earth is their home and they live out there in the wild, maybe in caves, wherever they live, who knows, but they can take their own consciousness and go interdimensionally throughout other dimensions. That could be a thing, and that could be why they have structures here, is because, and this is something I brought up with Eric, is, you know, because I'm wondering, why are there these structures? Because I've seen them, and they're impressive, and I don't think man can make the structures I've seen out in these forests. So are they structures that are depicting where maybe the vortex are and where you could actually go through into another dimension? I'm not sure, but that's just things that are going through my head. Is this, if they're a combination of both physical and interdimensional, then maybe they're physical to this planet and that they just have the abilities to interdimensional travel to other places beyond our abilities right at this moment, because I do believe humans can do that as well if you're at that capability.
Let's just think for a moment.
The bottom line is this, what if, going back to Gigi real quick, Rocco, let me just say this. Gigi, line is the Indians, the natives that are actually involved in this, who are having experiences to this day, are saying these people, they call them people, they walk in two worlds. And so, you know what? They're not writing books. They're not making movies. They're not signing up on History Channel or whatever to try to get a series. These are very private people. The people that I listened to in Pocatello, Idaho, they weren't even on the speaker list. They were so inspired by the white man speakers that came up that were sharing their research that they felt like they wanted to make sure that the people that were there, and there was a lot of people there, heard their story, and it was amazing. And I'll share that with you guys on my YouTube channel. later, but I'll just pause now. Let you guys talk for a minute.
Yeah.
And, now, Eric, good point. What if these Native American people are saying they live in two worlds, but they don't live in our world because we're so domesticated, but maybe perhaps that they live in this world because they do not want to be domesticated? Now, the other thing that really scares me is this. If they are out there walking around and these are real life, not interdimensional, how is it possible that these entities or these Bigfoot people, I shouldn't say entities, Bigfoot people have been walking around here and not have been so elusive that not a single person can be able to capture one and grab it, which drives me nuts because I saw it. I know what I saw, and I'm not going to change my perspective. And the six of us knew exactly what we saw. So it's there. I know it's there, but how could they be so elusive? It's so crazy to me.
Okay, so here's, let me just say this real quick. I think they're like a form of ETs. That's my basic, I'm just going to basically say that. And I'm also going to say this, is that if you do research into UFOs and UFO crashes and UFO crash retrievals and the bodies that have come out of these crash retrievals, that part of that whole UFO ET crash retrieval phenomena, and you take that and you apply it to the Bigfoot phenomena, you'll see a lot of parallels.
But big, ETs aren't building structures. But big ET is not building structures.
Yeah, I hear you there. But the structure thing is still a mystery. There's no doubt about it. I just know they're real. I just know humans didn't make them. There's no freaking way humans make them. The ones I've seen.
I agree.
Personally, my own eyes right there in person. There is no freaking way that humans made these things. It's just impossible. They would weigh too much. You would have to have like eight guys and four and with forestry jabbing these things up in the tree and another eight guys over here with another one. And they got to balance it perfectly. And then they got to put it on the ground. I mean, just there's just to me, I just don't see that as a reality, personally.
You would need at least eight guys, but you would also need a cherry picker, a crane, to get those up in the air like that and put them in position. The ones me and you saw, Eric, out there in the Ashley Forest with Ra, there's just right. No explanation on how they got there.
Off the grid, in the middle of the forest, way out there, Nowhereville.
Yeah, I mean...
Well, let me ask you this, JP or Gigi, have you ever seen... JP or Gigi, have you ever seen any of those things?
I've got a very long story that we don't have time for, so let's go to JP. JP, you're muted.
Good heavens. I'll wait till Gigi gives his answer, and then... And then I'll give mine.
Well, but my answer isn't even well to shortly answer question. No, I haven't. But I know someone that had a very descriptive experience that I know that several other people had the same exact description of an experience in an area that was right next to the forest, right by my house, where I grew up. But I did not specifically, I didn't experience Dick. So it's not really a good answer to your question, but, that's kind of why I went to JP.
How you want to wrap this up? We got 4 minutes, brother.
Dude, no, we have 2 minutes. We have 2 minutes.
All right. You're the boss. You do your thing.
They're slow by 2 minutes. Yeah. I think he's slow a little bit.
But
it's good to be. So Eric is he's 100% in. Rennell is 100% in. Rocker, are you 100% in?
I'm 100% in what I saw. I can tell you it's solid. It was concrete. I don't believe they're interdimensional. I believe they've been living among us. I don't know how or why, but I think the translation between the Native American people, two different worlds, is misconception. They're there. I don't know how they've been so elusive, but they are.
Wow.
Could be right. But then again, you got to keep in mind, Rocker, you had an experience, and what you experienced in that moment was your interpretation, but there are other people, lots of other people, that have had different experiences, and their interpretation was different because their experience was different. So I know you're a smart dude, Rocker, and I love you for that, and thank you for those freaking tires, dude. I'm so psyched about that. Brand new, sitting on my car right now. Appreciate it, bro.
Sweet.
Yeah, but the thing with our buddy Rocker here is his brother and his dad were also there.
I wasn't by myself.
Yeah,
it wasn't just me by myself. There was six of us.
We did a whole interview with them, and they all described the exact same thing. And, you know, especially with the Rocker being my partner in crime at conferences and knowing him for so long and doing the interview with his brother and his dad, it seems very clear to me, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that they witnessed
not to
the
mention
same thing.
Even further the pile of bones.
Oh boy, yeah, see, that's a whole nother thing. Man, I'll tell you what, you know what really sucks? We're on a really strict network schedule now, and we have to end right now. There's just no way around it. But if you guys want to hang out for a few minutes after the show off the air, we can continue this conversation a little bit. But for everyone else, unfortunately, our time is up. Our time is up because we've got Lighting the Void with Joe Roop coming up next right here on the Fringe FM. And then after that is the Jess Rogie Show, filling out the rest of the late night radio here on the Fringe FM. So with that, real quick, for our official guest tonight, where can everybody follow you and keep up with everything that is Jeff Rennell?
Over at www.eat.tv. You'll find shows like mine, JP's. Hopefully, we'll have Eric coming up there with E Talking. And a bunch of other great shows, and shows like this. So, yeah, come check me out there.
Perfect. There you go. Yeah, over there at eTalk.tv, ladies and gentlemen. He's got a whole situation going on over there. It's absolutely awesome. Bunch of great content.
How about you, Eric?
Go and check it out.
Oh, sorry, but you're done.
Eric, go ahead and plug it.
No, just you guys. The Awakening Man on Twitter. I mean, I'm going to do a show. I've already decided it's going to be called E-Talkin', T-A-L-K-I-N, E-Talkin' on E-Talk Radio. I'm just deciding, you know what? I'm not going to worry about co-hosts and all that other BS. I'm just going to do my own thing.
Yeah.
I've got a vision. I'm going to make it happen. You guys are going to love it. It's not going to be an hour. It's not going to be 2 hours. It might only be 30 minutes, but I'm going to try to give you guys like content every day, like a daily diary of E-Talk. Like, you guys have no freaking idea how many freaking conversations I have on the telephone every day for hours and how many rabbit holes I go down. I mean, I'm exhausted. I've already today had three and a half hours of conversations with people who know what the frick is going on. And I can't tell anybody about it because it's just, I will though. I'm going to spill the beans. It's coming. I promise it's coming.
All right, well, everybody, follow him at Awakening Man on Twitter, and keep up with everything Eric, because I know I am, and everybody else is too. So there you go. But with that, we have to leave 1 minute ago, so we're going to leave right now. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been Shift Habits here for the Fringe FM. This show is hosted and produced by yours truly, Gigi. You can follow me on Twitter at GGRabbit1, or better yet, follow the show on Twitter at ShiftHappensPod. And if that's too quick for you, just go to ShiftHappensRadio.com. All the links to all of our social media pages are there. Associate producer is Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter at ADSBradHarris. Co-host is JP. Where can they follow you, JP?
Okay, so Property of Mars is my website. It's under repair, but you can find me on eTalk TV, and that is, I am proud to be part of that group. So I look forward to doing some shows for eTalk.tv And I, yeah, same Property of Mars on there.
Fantastic. And with that, thanks for tuning in, folks. And we'll see you next week. But in the meantime, stay tuned, because coming up next, right here on the Fringe FM, is Lighting the Void with Joe, Mother, Bleepin', Roop! And then after that is the Jess Rogie Show. So stay tuned, folks. Finish the rest of your Friday paranormal night with the Fringe FM, with all of us right here. And we'll see you next week back here on Shift Happens. All right, folks. Have a great rest of your night.
Come back.
Come back, and we'll see you next weekend, folks. Have a good one.